Assalamualaikum. Today we are going to continue with the topic of intersection design, especially the signals. So last time we discussed some terms, what is a phase, cycle, interval, saturation headway, saturation flow rate, and then in the end we use these concepts to calculate the or to derive an equation for capacity of the intersection, right? So we have VC, which is the capacity, H is the headway, N is the number of phases, TL is the loss time per phase, and WC is the cycle length. Okay, and then we saw the relationship between cycle length and number of phases and the capacity, and which you can see in this graph as well. Now, if you use this equation, now what happens usually when you are doing some design, then you have the volume, right? VC is known and you are trying to calculate C. So in that case, C should go on the left hand side and everything else should come on the right hand side. So when you do that, the final equation will be this one. Okay, this one. So we'll call this equation as an equation for C minimum, minimum cycle length. Okay, and you can see all the other parameters and how it is coming. It is just a re-adjustment of the previous equation. Okay, the equation for VC, put VC on the left hand side or right hand side and C minimum on the left hand side. Okay. Now in this equation, there are two problems. First of all, you are designing for VC, which is the volume. And if you remember any of our previous discussions regarding capacity, capacity is never the volume, it is always a flow rate. Capacity is never the volume, it is always a flow rate. We use flow rate for level of service analysis as well. Before that, when we were discussing capacity, the concept of capacity, we said that you need to use flow rate because you have to incorporate for the sub-hourly fluctuations, and if you do not incorporate it, then you will have queues because of that, because of the fluctuation, and few minutes you can have a queue. We saw an example for the queue length as well. You will not reach the capacity. So first of all, you have to convert this volume into flow rate. Okay, so volume upon flow rate is peak hour factor. Volume upon flow rate is peak hour factor. We already know that. So volume upon peak hour factor will give you the flow rate. So first thing we'll do is divide volume with the peak hour factor, which is you can see in this equation. So volume is divided by peak hour factor, so that we are designing for flow rate, maximum flow rate, not maximum volume. Second problem with this equation is if you design the C minimum using the exact volume or the flow rate, whatever the case is, then in the peak hour, the capacity of the cycle length is equal to the actual flow rate. And we have already discussed this is not a good situation because when you are at capacity means what? Capacity means what? Capacity means that there is no margin of error now. There is no flexibility now. Drivers do not have any comfort level, right? We already discussed in level of service analysis as well, and even before that. Okay, so we will never design for capacity. We don't want the volume in the peak hour, the flow rate in the peak hour to be exactly equal to the capacity. Okay. Now, if it was a highway, then capacity means you will be like going one after another. There is no space for changing the lane and so on and so forth. Capacity for a signal means that every time the signal becomes red, you will have a very long queue. Just give me a minute. Okay, what was I saying? Yeah, so if it is a highway, then your capacity means that you don't have any margin of you don't have any space, you cannot accelerate and so on and so forth. Capacity for a signal means that every time the signal becomes red, you will see a very long queue. Okay, and obviously long queue means that if there will be some drivers who will be waiting for a very long time. Okay, and even for pedestrians, they will find it very hard to cross. Well, once the signal becomes red, there will be so many vehicles passing. Okay, now if you are exactly at capacity, which is very very doubtful, right? You are designing for capacity and you are hoping that no, vehicles will be exactly this value. This is very doubtful. The traffic is random, right? So every time you may have increase, a slight increase in the value, we will go oversaturated. Okay. Now, even if you reach that value, let's say you are exactly at that capacity. Now, what will happen? You will have a very long queue. Okay. Every time the queue, the signal becomes green, that queue will go off. But every time the signal becomes red, you will have a long queue again. And if that, in that queue, if there's a slow driver, if there's a learning driver, if there's a new driver, if there are one or two more heavy vehicles, you will not get rid of the queue and you will go in oversaturated condition, in traffic jam condition, you will go over capacity. Okay, so we can do not want to design for capacity. We have to design for a capacity which is higher than the actual flow rate, higher than the actual flow rate. So I have to divide the actual flow rate with a factor which is known as V by C, meaning volume to capacity ratio. Okay, so volume capacity ratio is between 0.8 to 0.95. So the actual flow rate, which is Vc upon PHF, is further divided by V by C ratio, which is one of these values, a value, with a value within this range. And then you will have, you know, a higher flow rate than the actual one, right? If you divide the flow rate with a fraction value, then the value will be higher. So you are not designing for Vc by PHF. You are designing for a higher value than Vc by PHF by dividing it with V by C ratio. So after converting the volume to flow rate and dividing by V by C ratio, the cycle length which you will calculate will be no longer termed as minimum cycle length. You will call it desirable cycle length. And this is the one which you will use for your design. The desirable cycle length is used for design. Minimum is just used for checking. Minimum is just if you have already have a signal, you already have volume, you want to check if this is enough or not, then you will use minimum. But for design, you will use this one, this equation. Okay, this is a fine equation for design. Okay, let us see the effect of V by C ratio. So we have a three-phase signal, loss times 4 seconds per phase. Saturation headway is given, peak hour factor is given, volume is 1200. And we have to check what happens to the cycle length when we change the ratio from 0.8 to 1. Okay, so you have to use different values starting from 0.8, V by C ratio of 0.8, going up to 1. Okay, now you can do 0.81, 0.82, 0.83, and you can go on like this. But in the book, they have used an interval of 0.05. So after 0.8, they use 0.85, then 0.8, 0.9, then 0.95, then 1. Okay, so you can see four values here. Okay, five values actually. So the equation for desirable cycle length is this one. This is the basic equation, right? So here you can see N, which is the number of phases, 3. TL, loss time per phase, 3 seconds per phase. Saturation headway, 2.2 seconds per vehicle. 0.9 is the peak hour factor, and then we will be changing V by C ratio. Okay, so when you use the V by C ratio of 1, your cycle length is 64.8 and you will round it up to 65 seconds. It's a design problem, so you cannot round it off to 60 or 64. You have to round it off, right? Round it up. Then in the second case, only V by C ratio has changed, 0.95. So the answer is 84.3. Again, round off, round it up to 85. Third case, 126.7 and round off to 130. Okay, so now you can see the values are not rounded off to the nearest second. They are rounded off to the nearest 5 seconds. Okay, so 126.7 was not made into 127. It was made into 130. Okay, so cycle lengths are always rounded off to nearest 5 seconds, at least. Nearest 5 seconds. Then when you have 0.85, 0.290 seconds, when you have 0.8, you see it's a negative value. It's a negative value. Negative cycle length doesn't make any sense. You cannot accept it. You have to discard this value. What does it mean? It means that the values you have used in this equation, all the values. Okay, I'm not talking about just V by C ratio, because sometimes you will not change V by C ratio, you will change some other things. So whatever combination of values you have used in the desirable equation, C desirable equation, these values cannot give you a practical answer. These values cannot give you a possible answer. So the negative value means change the values in the equation. In this question, they have changed V by C ratio. And you can see when we increase the V by C ratio, negative value goes off. So negative was at 0.8. When I made it 0.85, it became a positive value. Okay. So when, if you have a negative desirable cycle length, discard that value, cannot use that value. Don't just make it an absolute. Okay. Don't just cancel out the negatives and use the value. Okay. It's not possible. So one of the ways to convert the C desirable into a positive value, if you are having a negative answer, then is to increase the V by C ratio. It's to increase the V by C ratio. Another thing which you can see in this example is when I increase the V by C ratio, cycle length decreases. Okay, you can see it here. Minimum cycle length when I have maximum V by C ratio. Okay, and similarly 0.85, 0.8 I cannot use, is a negative answer. So 0.85, which is the minimum V by C ratio, gives me the highest cycle length. Why? Because V by C ratio increases the capacity of the signal. And for higher capacity, you need more cycle length. So when you decrease the V by C ratio, you are increasing the capacity, right? This is the aim of putting the V by C ratio here, right? So your capacity is more than the actual. So when you put V by C ratio of 1, that means your capacity is exactly the actual flow rate. So your cycle length is less. Now when you put 0.95, that means I'm increasing the flow rate to higher than the actual, so I need more cycle length. Okay, and so 0.95 will increase it less than 0.9. So capacity is higher with 0.9 as compared to 0.95. So if you increase the capacity, then you need higher cycle length as well. Okay, so whenever you decrease the V by C ratio, then you are basically increasing the capacity, that means more cycle length. Now let us look at another example here. A intersection is given, volume for both directions is given. You can see it in the figure here. Okay, so east-west 1800, north-south 1200 vehicles per hour. They have given me an initial cycle length here, 60 seconds. This is just initial value. You can say assumed or given. Okay, then the other data is fixed. To lost time per phase, 4 seconds, two phases, 0.95 peak hour factor, 0.9 V by C ratio, and 2.3 seconds per vehicle is the saturation headway. Okay. Now they want me to find out number of lanes in each direction. How many lanes should be in the east-west direction? How many lanes should be in the north-south direction? Okay. So I will calculate it using the initial cycle length, and then I can change it. Then I will find out the actual desirable cycle length. Okay. So this will become my minimum cycle length. Okay. So I will first of all find out with this cycle length how much capacity I have. How much capacity I have with this cycle length. Okay. So I'm calculating VC. So I will use the equation which we derived in the last lecture. This one. Okay. So VC I'm trying to find out. H is 2.3 seconds per vehicle. Number of phases 2. Lost time per phase 4. And C, I will take it as initial given or assumed value, which is 60 seconds. So with this value, VC comes out to be 1357 vehicles per hour, 1357 vehicles per hour. So with 60 seconds of cycle length and these parameters, the maximum volume I can have from all directions is 1357 vehicles per hour. 1357 vehicles per hour. Now look at the actual volume I have in both directions. 1800 in one direction, 1200 in the other direction. So the total will be 3000 vehicles per hour. Okay, so 60 seconds of cycle length cannot bear 3000 vehicles per hour. It is oversaturated. Okay, now what should I do to make it acceptable? What should I do to make it under this value? I should increase the number of lanes. Okay. You can try other things as well. Like I said, there are many things in this equation which you can try. V by C ratio is one of them. Now, peak hour factor you cannot change. Peak hour factor cannot be changed because this is from the volume. Saturation headway you cannot change again because this is coming from the field. You have to observe how much headway is between the drivers. Okay. Lost time also depends upon saturation headway as well as clearance loss time, which depends upon the geometry of the intersection. You cannot change it as well. Okay, so these values cannot be changed. Loss time, peak hour factor, saturation headway cannot be changed. Okay, you can change other factors. So in the previous example, we saw that we can change V by C ratio as well. But in this example, they have given me another task, which is to change the number of lanes. So now I will change the number of lanes. Now, total volume in this direction is 1800. Okay. Now, when I say 1800 plus 1200, I mean what? I am taking one lane in each direction. So this full 1800 is coming in this direction, in this lane, and this full 1200 is coming in this lane. Okay. So I have already assumed one lane in each direction when I said full 1800 and full 1200. Now, if I increase the number of lanes, what will happen? This 1800 will be divided into two lanes. So each lane will have 900, right? Each lane will have a volume of 900. Now, these 900 vehicles are passing simultaneously. So I'm not actually designing a signal for 1800 vehicles. I'm only designing it for 900 vehicles. If 900 can pass from one lane, then 900 can pass from the other lane as well. So there is no problem. Okay. So first of all, now you can say, okay, provide three lanes in each direction and problem solved. Okay. We don't do it like this. We will do it one by one, first of all. Why one by one? Because each time you increase the number of lanes, you are increasing the cost of the highway. Okay. And you need more space as well. We want to minimize it. Okay. So we'll increase one lane at a time, and if it is satisfies our capacity, we'll stop there. Okay, so don't just randomly put any number of lanes. Okay, try one lane at a time, because this is connected to cost and everything else. Okay. Now, in which direction should I increase the number of lanes? The obvious answer is the direction which has more volume. The direction which has more volume should have more number of lanes. So I will start with increasing number of lanes in the east-west direction. Okay, so the initial volume is 300 vehicles per hour. Okay, so if I increase the number of lanes in the east-west direction, so each lane will carry 900, because 1800 will be divided into 2. So now I'm designing for 900 plus 1200 in the north-south direction. So 9 plus 1200 means 2100. Which is still over my capacity. So increasing two lanes in the east-west direction did not solve my problem. I need to increase one more lane somewhere. Now again, where should I increase more lane? The direction which has more volume. Now 1200 is more, right? 1200 is higher than 900. So the number of lanes should be increased in the north-south direction. So if you increase one more lane in the north-south direction, then 1200 will be divided by 2. You will have 600 in each lane. So 600 in each lane for the north-south direction, and 900 in each lane for the east-west direction. So total will be 6 plus 9, meaning 1500 vehicles per hour, which is still over my capacity. So I will not stop here. I will increase one more lane. One more lane where? Again. Now east-west direction volume per lane is higher. Increase one lane here. So you have now 1800 total divided by 3 lanes. So it will be 600 in each lane, and east-west remain 600 in each lane. So 600 plus 600 is now 1200, which is below my capacity. So this is fine. So this is my final design. What is final design? Two lanes in north-south direction, three lanes in east-west direction. You are designing for a volume of 1200. Okay. And now I will use this value to calculate the desirable cycle length. Okay. So now I have finalized. First of all, I fixed the cycle length, and I found how many lanes and VC, the number of lanes and VC. So number of lanes change VC as well. In this example, you have seen how number of lanes can change the value of VC. Okay, so now I will use this VC to calculate the desirable cycle length. Okay, the equation for desirable cycle length is this one. Okay, so you will use this equation. Let me write down the values which we are going to use. (0.8 to 0.1) means in the previous example, you had to try different values ranging from 0.8 to 1. So in the previous example, we were not doing it for one value, we're doing it for a range of values. Okay, but in this example, now you see, they've only given me one value. Okay, so number of phases here, actually you can see the value. Let me make it bigger so you can see the values. Okay, so 60 second cycle length, no longer required. Okay, or we are using desirable cycle length, right? Desirable cycle length as this equation, okay? So you use this equation. So you use this equation to calculate the desirable cycle length, this one. So n is 2 phases given. Lost time per phase given as 4 seconds. VC 1200, which we just calculated. Peak hour factor 0.95. V by C 0. Okay. We need H as well. So H is 2.3 seconds per peak. So give me the value of desirable cycle length. This value. Want this value. Yeah, desirable cycle length. Okay, 77.43 seconds. So this is our final design, that C desirable. So again, you will make it 80 seconds, right? You will make it 80 seconds. Okay. Now, so final design is what? Three lanes east-west, because it has more volume. Two lanes north-south, okay. Other factors are given, and the cycle length should be 80 seconds. This is my final design, okay? Now let's say somebody comes, I present this design to the ministry or to the traffic directorate. Traffic directorate says we cannot have three lanes in any direction. So you have to limit your design to two lanes in each direction. Two lanes in each direction. Now two lanes in each direction means what? If you give two lanes in each direction, then your volume is 1500, right? Two lanes in each direction means volume is 1500. 600 in each lane for north-south and 900 in each lane for east-west. So if you put VC as 1500, then how much will be your cycle length? So all other parameters will remain the same, but just change the VC from 1200 to 1500. Okay, then how much will be your cycle length if your VC is 1500? Yes, it's the same equation. Everything else is the same. Just VC is changed from 1200 to 1500. How much do you get? How much is that desirable cycle length? Yes, hurry up. Yes, desirable cycle length, everything is the same. VC is 1500. Why is that taking so long? No, this is wrong. You are increasing the VC. How can you get lower cycle length? You are increasing the volume. How can you get lower cycle length? You got 77 with 1200. How can you get lower with 1500? I don't know what you guys are doing. N is 2, TL is 4, VC is 1500. Peak hour factor is 0.95 and B by C ratio is 0.9, AH is 2.3. The same equation which you must have put in your calculator, you just change VC in there. And Ali is the only one I think is doing. Other guys, I don't know. Sleeping? It's a bad time to sleep. It's afternoon. Yes, what happened? If you don't want to do it, fine. Just go ahead. Okay, moving on, critical lane concept. So in the last example, we assumed that every lane has the same volume. So when you increase the number of lanes, just the volume is divided by 2 and okay, or divided by 3, like the total volume divided by the number of lanes. Okay, but in reality, this is not the case. All lanes do not carry equal volume. Volume is not divided equally among the lanes. Okay, so we have a concept of critical lane. Critical lane is the lane which carries more intensive traffic. More intensive most probably will mean more volume. The volume which carries, the lane which carries more volume becomes a critical lane. So for any signal, for all phases of the signal, you have to identify a critical lane. The lane which carries more intensive traffic, most probably meaning more volume. But in some cases, it may not mean more volume, it can mean more time as well. For example, if you have two lanes which are carrying equal volume, but one of the lanes is for left turning, obviously the vehicles which are turning left, although they are in the same number, but they will take more time. So the critical lane will become the left turning lane, although it has the same volume. Okay, or in some cases, even if it has a slightly lower value, it can become the critical lane because even with low number of vehicles, it can take more time. Turning vehicles take more time than straight vehicles, so critical lane is defined as generally more lane carrying more intensive traffic. Okay, so for each phase you have to identify which one is the critical lane, which lane will carry more intensive traffic. Secondly, for that lane, find out how much volume you have. Okay, so you are designing for the volume in the critical lane only. Okay, obviously other lanes are less intensive, so they will pass simultaneously without any problem. Then for that lane, find out the startup and clearance loss times. Now startup and clearance loss times usually do not depend upon or do not change for each lane or for each direction. They are usually for the entire intersection. Okay, so for example, startup loss time is the time taken by the drivers to move. Okay, so the first driver is taking some time to move. So usually driver behavior is the same in all directions. Okay, so the extra headway which you are consuming in, let's say, east direction will be the same or approximately the same in the west direction as well as in the other directions. Similarly, clearance loss time depends upon how much time you need to clear the intersection. So that depends upon the geometry of the intersection, the dimension of the intersection. Okay, so it doesn't depend upon which lane you are doing or which direction you are doing. Okay, so startup and clearance loss time are usually the same. If you want to find out for each direction and for each lane, it's up to you. Like I said, they are approximately same, but you want to do it very exact, very accurate calculations, you do it for each lane as well. Okay, no problem. Okay, so the green time or the phase for each each phase, the timing of each phase will be calculated according to the movement of vehicle in the critical lane. Okay, so everything is now focused on the critical lane. Okay, other lanes, if they are going simultaneously with your critical lane, other lanes are not important. Okay, once you have identified a critical lane for any phase, then all your calculations will be according to the movement of vehicle in that lane, how much flow rate you have in that lane, and so on and so forth. So some important points regarding the critical lane. Every phase should have a critical lane, and that phase will only be designed for the flow in that lane. Okay, so every phase should have only one critical lane, and so on. Except for the loss times, there should be one critical lane open during the remaining time of the cycle. Except for the loss times, there should be one critical lane open during the remaining times of the cycle. Now, loss time means what? First time, for example, loss time means the all red time, the clearance loss time. So all signals are red, so all critical lanes are closed. Other loss time is the startup loss time. Now the lane is open, but the driver is still not, the drivers haven't started moving. So although if you look at the signal is showing one critical lane is open, but the driver in that lane is taking some time. So again, it is considered as a loss time. And so except for these two times, there should be vehicles moving, vehicles moving from at least one critical lane during the remaining time of the cycle. Okay, so you subtract the critical the loss times and whatever remaining time you have, in that remaining time at least one critical lane should be open. Wherever you are going overlapping phases, okay, you will decide the overlapping based upon the best combination or the highest combination of critical lane volumes, critical lane flows. Now overlapping means what? You have two phases, there are two phases, two different phases, so each phase will have its own critical lane. But either the start time or the end time of these phases is the same. Either their start time is the same or the end time is the same. Okay, these are called as overlapping phases. Now, for example, if there's two different phases starting and ending at the same time, so they will no longer be two phases, they will be one phase. Then you will look for one critical lane for that whole phase. Okay, if the start and end of two different direction is the same, if the start and end time of two different directions is the same, that means although they are in different directions, but they are in the same phase. So for all those directions which have same start and end time, you will just look for one critical lane. Okay, so there is no combination. But when they are overlapping phases, and let me give an example here. For example, which two movements you can allow? You must have seen this one, straight and left. So straight starts first, and then after a few seconds you see the left turning has started. So this is a common overlapping which you see. Again, a very common overlapping is this straight movement. Okay, don't mind my drawing, it doesn't look straight, but believe me, it's straight. And this straight movement, these two straight movements can also be overlapped. So you may have seen it on some highways that two straight movements are happening simultaneously with a difference of few seconds. So these two overlappings are completely safe. So let's say at an intersection, you are looking at both of them. you're deciding should I go with this overlapping, the one on the right hand side or the one on the left hand side. So you have to look which one will give you the highest combination of critical lane volumes. Okay, so for example, for the straight movement, critical lane volume is 600. So there's a lane which has the most intensive traffic, and that lane has a volume of 600. The left turning lane, if there's only one left turning lane, obviously that will become the critical lane, right? If there's only one lane in that direction, that automatically becomes the critical lane. Okay, so let's say the left turning lane has a volume of 400. Okay, so the combination of critical lane volumes for this overlapping is 1000, right? 600 plus 400. Now if you come here, this one is 600, like I said, and the other straight movement is 500, let's say. Okay, the other one is 500. So if you give this overlapping, then the combined volume is 600 plus 500, which is 1100. So this one is more beneficial than this one. You will select the one on the left hand side because the combination of critical lane volumes is high. Okay, now let us come to measures of effectiveness. Measures of effectiveness means things which you can use to find out the level of service on the intersections. Now don't worry, we will not go into the calculations of level of service because they take more time and they are a lot, like they are very complicated. So we'll not do it in this course. Maybe later on, if you take advanced traffic, we may do it there. So measures effectiveness means things which you can use. So if you know the procedure for level of service, you can use one of these things to find out the level of service. Okay. Now, why we need extra measures of effectiveness for intersections? Why don't we use the measures which we have used for highways? For highways, we use what? Flow rate, speed, and density. For calculation of level of service, we use these three things. Now, we cannot use them for intersections. First of all, speed cannot use. At intersections, the speed is almost zero. You have to stop. Flow, again, you are stopping the flow. Flow cannot be used. Density means what? Vehicles per mile. Intersections are a very short distance. So you cannot have vehicles per mile there, right? Vehicles per mile for highways, which have some length. And length of the highway is usually more than 1 mile, okay? So these measures of effectiveness cannot be applied to intersections. So we have to opt for measures of effectiveness which can be applied to intersections, things which happen on intersections. For example, what things happen on intersection? Delay happens. We have queues. We have vehicles stopping at the intersection. So these are the measures of effectiveness for intersections. So delay is defined as the difference between time consumed in traversing the intersection and the difference between the arrival and the departure time. Okay. So if there is no difference between the arrival and the departure time, that means your delay is zero or your delay is less. You came and you went through the intersection, your delay will be less. Now, if you have less delay, that means the intersection is more effective. If effectiveness increases, if the delay is less, it makes sense, right? More effective intersections, more effective signals should have less delay. So delay is just simply the time which you consume in going through the intersection. Okay. Then we have queue. Queue is basically how many vehicles are stopping in the queue behind the stop line. Okay, so you count the number of vehicles. The stop, number of vehicles stops, or percentage of vehicles which have to stop at the intersection. Okay, again, queue and stops, they have inverse relationship with effectiveness. Less vehicles in the queue means more effective, and less number of vehicles which have to stop, or less percentage of vehicles which have to stop on the intersection means more effectiveness. Okay, and vice versa. So queue and stops are, they are related to each other, right? If you are stopping in the queue, that means the queue length is increasing and the number of vehicles are also, number of vehicles stopped are also increasing. Now, out of these measures, the most important one is delay. The most important one is delay, and delay is affected by queue as well as number of stops as well. And we will see it in the calculations later on. Delay can be of four types. Delay at the intersection or delay at the signal can be of four types. Stop delay, approach delay, time in queue delay, and travel time delay. A stop delay means the time during which you are stopped at the intersection or at the signal. Okay, this is simple. So whenever the vehicle comes, it stops. Stop delay starts, vehicle starts moving, stop delay ends. Then we approach delay. approach delay was defined earlier as control delay. We defined the term approach delay as control delay earlier. It means the same thing. Okay, while control delay was something general, approach delay is related to the signals. So what is approach delay or control delay? How did we define it earlier? It has three parts. First of all, the stop delay. Then before stopping, you decelerate. So deceleration is also part of approach delay or control delay. And then after you start moving again, after the stop, you start moving again. And you take some time to accelerate back to your desired speed or back to the original speed, initial speed. That acceleration part or re-acceleration part is also part of approach or control delay. So approach or control delay has three parts: deceleration before stopping, then stop time, then re-acceleration back to your speed. Okay, so this is known as approach delay or control delay. Then we have time in queue delay. Time in queue delay is the time spent by the vehicle in the queue. Okay, and we have already discussed again when we were discussing delay measurement that vehicle is considered in the queue till it crosses the stop line. Okay, so time in queue delay is not stop delay. There are two different things. Time in queue delay is when the vehicle joins the queue till the time vehicle moves from the stop line. Okay, so you are moving with the queue, you have not reached the stop line, that means you are still in the queue. Okay, so time in queue delay can still be, time in queue delay can still be, can still happen if you are moving. Then we have travel time delay. Travel time delay is the difference between your actual travel time and your desired travel time. Actual travel time and desired travel time for the intersection or for any segment. For intersection or any segment, travel time delay remains the same. Definition of travel time delay remains the same. Now, actual travel time will be observed. How much travel time is taken by the vehicle? Actually, you will go to the road and observe it. You will note it down yourself. We have discussed travel time studies earlier, so you can know the actual travel time. How do I know the desired travel time? Desired travel time is calculated by using the free flow speed and the distance we have to travel. The free flow speed and the distance we have to travel. So distance upon speed will give you the time, right? Distance upon speed will give you the time. So you will use free flow speed and the distance you have to travel. So if it's an intersection, then it will be the width of the intersection divided by the free flow speed. This will give you desired travel time. Okay, and the actual travel time you will calculate it, you will observe it. Okay, and if it's a highway segment, then you will take the length of the segment. Okay, so this is how you calculate desired travel time. And then you take the difference of actual and desired, you will get the travel time delay. Okay, in this figure, you can see three types of delays. Okay, so on the y-axis, you have distance. On the x-axis, you have time. So if you take the slope of any line on this figure, you will get a speed, right? Distance upon time. So now let us see how we can calculate the three types of delay from this graph. First of all, if you know the free flow speed, that will become the slope of a line on this graph. So if you plot a line using the free flow speed as a slope, that will be called as the desired path of the vehicle. Remember, we said desired travel time. So this is a desired path of the vehicle. Okay, so first of all, you can do something which is use the free flow speed as the slope. And according to that slope, plot a line, okay? And that line will show the desired path of the vehicle. Then you plot the actual path of the vehicle using the actual speed and the actual stopping time and so on. So this is the actual speed, okay? Now, if you take the difference between the desired path and the actual path at any point, this will give you what? Travel time delay. This is how we define travel time delay, right? The difference between desired path and actual path. So take the difference between desired path and actual path on this graph, you will get travel time delay. Okay. Now you see there is a part of the line where there is a part of the graph where the actual path is a horizontal line. Horizontal line means what? Stopped. The vehicle is stopped, no distance covered, right? So if you take the length of this portion, the horizontal portion, you will get a stop delay. Okay. Length of the horizontal portion of the actual path will give you the stop delay. Okay, because the vehicle is not moving. So this is why the line is horizontal. Now, before the line becomes horizontal, you can see the slope becomes very flat. There is a slope, but it is very flat. So this is a deceleration. Then after the vehicle starts moving, again it starts with a very flat slope. This is acceleration, and then it goes back to a stable speed. Okay, so if you add the time of deceleration and the time of acceleration with the stop time, you will get what? Approach delay. Remember, approach delay, control delay. These were the three parts, right? Deceleration, stopping, and acceleration. So if you take the time from the start of deceleration to the end of acceleration, this will give you approach delay. Okay. So these are three types of delays you can calculate from plotting the actual and the desired path of the vehicle. Now, delay can be aggregate delay or average individual delay. Aggregate delay means total delay of all vehicles on the road. Total delay of all vehicles on the road. So the units will be number of vehicles into time. Number of vehicles into time. Vehicle seconds, vehicle minutes, or vehicle hours. Okay, but this is the total delay for all vehicles on that intersection. And we call it the aggregate delay. And the units are vehicle seconds, vehicle minutes, or vehicle hours. Okay. And I think we did it in chapter 3, I think. Okay, so we calculate the delay in vehicle hours, I think. Because it was in vehicle minutes and we convert to vehicle hours. Then we have average individual delay, which is the delay caused to each vehicle. So it will be seconds per vehicle. Seconds per vehicle. Delay caused to each individual vehicle. So it will be average, obviously. All vehicles will face different value of delay, but then you take an average. Okay. Now, the last thing which we'll discuss is the... So first of all, in the previous figure, I showed you three types of delays. We did not show time in queue delay. So time in queue delay can be taken from this graph. Okay. Now, today I will explain this graph. Tomorrow I will move on to the calculation of the delay. So just keep in mind, this graph and the calculations are for a case of uniform flow or uniform delay conditions. Okay, uniform flow or uniform delay conditions, which is when the intersection is undersaturated. Intersection is undersaturated. When the intersection is oversaturated, the delay or flow is not uniform. The delay or flow is not uniform, meaning the delay can change rapidly even with addition of one vehicle in the flow. Up to the saturation level, up to the level of capacity, delay changes with respect to the volume, with respect to flow. But after capacity, the delay does not have a linear or direct relationship with the flow. Okay, so this is why that is not considered as uniform flow. Okay, and I will explain to you with the form of in the end with this graph as well. Okay, so in this graph, on the x-axis is time, on the y-axis we have vehicles. So if you take the slope of any line on this graph, this will give you flow. Vehicles per unit time, right? Vehicles per unit time is what? Flow. Now, when the signal is green, vehicles are coming and they are leaving. So their rate of arrival and rate of departure, meaning flow of arrival and flow of departure, is the same. So you see one line here. Till the signal is green, there's only one line. So this one line represents flow of vehicles arriving and flow of vehicles departing. When the signal becomes red, flow of vehicle arriving continues. Vehicles are still coming, and they will go where? They will not go anywhere. They will form a queue. So when that signal is red, the rate of departure or the flow of departure is zero. Okay. So you see a horizontal line here. So this horizontal line indicates. So now we have two lines. One for rate or flow of arrival, which is termed as small v. So small v is rate of flow of arrival, and the other one is for rate or flow of departure, which is during the red phase, zero. During the red phase, it is zero. Okay. Now, if you take the difference between the arrival and departure line, vertical difference, you will get the number of vehicles in the queue. Okay. So how many vehicles came? So since vehicles are not leaving, so this difference is created because of the number of vehicles in the queue. Okay. The vehicles which are coming are going where? They are coming, going in the queue. So the difference between the arrival and departure will give you number of vehicles in the queue. Okay. Then time in queue delay for any vehicle. So a vehicle arrives at this time, let's say time I, and this vehicle leaves at this time. Okay. Let's say time I dash, or let's say time T and time T1. So vehicle I arrives at time T and leaves at T1. If you take the horizontal difference between the two lines, it will give you time in queue delay. If you take the horizontal difference between the arrival and the departure line, this will give you time in queue delay. So the fourth type of delay is taken from this graph. Okay, so you have to plot a different sort of a graph here. Okay, once the signal becomes green, the vehicle start moving. Their flow or rate of departure is equal to S, and we already defined S as saturation flow rate, if you remember, saturation flow rate. So vehicles depart at saturation flow rate. This is what we have discussed, right? Vehicles during effective green time, they are moving at saturation headway, and at that time their flow rate is equal to saturation flow rate. So their flow rate of departure is now saturation flow rate once the signal becomes green. Now you see vehicles are leaving and leaving and leaving, and there's a time when the queue will completely go off. The queue will be completely eliminated. So when there are no vehicles in the queue, that means the arrival and departure line will meet, right? Like I told you, the difference between the arrival line and departure line is the number of vehicles in the queue. So if there are no vehicles in the queue, that means the two lines will meet each other. Okay, so this is the condition of uniform flow, that during the green time, the arrival and departure line will meet again. Okay, if they do not meet, that means the queue remains. You have the next red, and the arrival and departure line did not meet. That means the queue is still there from the previous red phase, and this is oversaturation condition, and then our calculations will no longer apply. For that, we have to have a different set of a calculation for a different set of equations. Okay, so for uniform flow and uniform delay condition, it is important that once the signal becomes green, the queue dissipates completely. The queue eliminates completely, meaning arrival and departure line should meet each other. Okay, so this is the condition of uniform flow. Tomorrow we will discuss its equations. Okay, I'm going for the attendance now. Dua Rabi, Amna Muhammad, Muhammad Usama. Dua Rabi, Amna Muhammad, Muhammad Usama. Muhammad Noman, Ali Muhammad, Hakima Ali, Zahra Sayyid. Muhammad Noman, Ali Muhammad, Hakima Ali, Zahra Sayyid. Ali Muhammad Noman. Fawaz Adil Abdul Rahman Ibrahim Nujus Salah. Fawaz Adil Abdul Rahman Ibrahim Nujus Salah. Fawaz and Abdul Rahman. Nujud Nadeen Hussam Zahra Riyad Abu Bakr Ghani. Nadeen Hussam Zahra Riyad Abu Bakr Ghani. Nujud Nadeen Zahra Abu Bakr Ke. Zainab Ali Ahmad Lulwa Ibrahim Mariam Abdul Amir Masht Bashir. Zainab Ali Ahmad, Lulwa Ibrahim, Mariam Abdul Amir, Majd Bashir. Zainab Ali Lulwa. Okay, Mariam, Majd, Asir Hassan, Ali Mustafa. Asir Hassan, Ali Mustafa. Okay. Ali, Hamad Khalid, Abdullah Husamuddin. Hamad Khalid, Abdullah Husamuddin. Abdullah Husamuddin, Latifa Ahmad, Fatma Abdali, Zainab Abdali. Latifa Ahmad, Fatma Abdali, Zainab Abdali. Fatma, Latifa, Zainab. Ala Salman, Isra Abdul Karim, sorry. Zainab Abdul Al, Ala Salman, Isra Abdul Karim, Ali Abdul Razak. Zainab Abdul Al, Ala Salman, Isra Abdul Karim, Ali Abdul Razak. Isra and Zainab. Okay, Ali, Elizabeth Ann and Ali Makki. Elizabeth Ann and Ali Makki. Okay, I'm done from this section, going to section one now. Anybody from section one? From section one. Huda Hassan, okay. दाना, ईसा, महमूद आदिल, फातमा, ओके डन, एवरीबॉडी डन, ओके थैंक यू, सी यू गाइस टुमारो इंशाल्लाह, अस्सलाम वालेकुम।